In this life, we are often saying goodbye to folks, knowing that we shall see them no more. It's a part of what it is to be here as a pilgrim on this earth. There are many things that cause us to have to say goodbye to folks. And I know that when it comes to death, that's the ultimate goodbye as far as this life is concerned. But there are those goodbyes that are not bad. The person who learns the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is God's power to save us, Romans 1:16, who from the heart obeys that gospel, says goodbye to a practiced habitual life of sin, and says hello to a new creature in Christ Jesus, a member of the Lord's church. But I want us to concentrate on a goodbye that we all must make. But it's a good goodbye. There's a time coming when the faithful will see their enemies no more. We become so accustomed to wicked things in this world, the devil's control of things, that we become sort of hardened to it. And there's a sense in which being a faithful child of God, you must become hardened to it to be able to live in it, because we are not of the world, but we're in the world. I want to read to you from Deuteronomy 4, verses 39 and 40. Know therefore this day, Moses says, and let me pause here and say, Deuteronomy means a restatement of the law. It's just before Moses dies and before the children of Israel, led by Joshua, go over into the land of Canaan. So he's going back through the law of Moses with them once again. And so he says, know therefore this day and consider it in thine heart, that the Lord, he is God in heaven above and upon the earth beneath. There is none else. Thou shalt keep therefore his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee this day, that it may go well with thee and with thy children after thee, and that thou mayest prolong thy days upon the earth, which the Lord thy God giveth thee forever. Of course, I might make comment in passing that the term forever many times in the law of Moses or in the Old Testament doesn't mean eternally, as we use the word eternal, but it means in the duration of time that God has in mind, such as the law of Moses lasting forever. Well, it would be forever from the standpoint of the time God intended it to be applicable to the Jews. But be that as it may, it's obvious that if the children of Israel were to remain in the land of Canaan, that the great requirement is that you do what God told you to do. You keep his commandments. Remember this land he had promised for years and years, going back many, many generations. He had promised even this people that from them would come a Savior. And of course, these thoughts are developed all the way through the Old Testament, especially, I think, of the book of Isaiah. But after noticing what we just read in Deuteronomy 4, 39 through 40, God said to Moses, oh, that there were such a heart in them that they would fear me and keep all my commandments always, that it might be well with them and with their children forever. Chapter 5 and verse 29. It's difficult for us to think for a moment and to have a comprehension that really would be good to have of what it would be like to be owned by somebody else, a slave, in bondage, in this case, as Jews, to the Egyptians. They were at the mercy of their taskmasters for many, many years. But after witnessing God bring about these 10 plagues upon the Egyptians, the people had certainly sufficient evidence to cause them to realize God had the power to deliver them. Moses was the deliverer. But then when you see the impact that all these things had upon the Egyptians, you wonder, what were they thinking? They were idolatrous people, and yet every one of those plagues was against one of their gods. And these things were sufficient to cause Pharaoh and all of the Egyptians to say, Moses is the true spokesman from the only true and living God. Yet he was not that way. He hardened his heart. He rejected the evidence. And that's how you harden your heart. But finally, he reluctantly let the Israelites begin to leave Egypt. But then we see that Pharaoh very quickly had a change of heart. The scripture says that he made ready 600 chosen chariots, Exodus 14, verses 6 and 7. And that was to pursue the Israelites and bring them back as slaves. In Exodus 14, 10, and when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them. Now notice the impact. And they were sore afraid. We wouldn't say it that way today. We would say very much afraid, terrorized. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. Exodus 14, 10. Now, I said we were going to talk about there was a time coming